Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and this is the all-new 16-inch MacBook Pro. This is something I've been looking forward to for a very long time, and this is going to be my main editing machine. And so I picked this up myself. I bought this. Apple did not send this to me. So let's take a look at the specs. You can see that this is the 64GB memory version with 4TB of storage, and it's the 16-inch MacBook Pro. It has the 10-core CPU with 8 performance cores and 2 efficiency cores, a 32-core GPU, a 16-core neural engine, and 400 gigabytes a second of memory bandwidth. Now let's go ahead and open it up. So on the top, we have a pull tab here, and we'll take this off here. Let's open it up. And this is a very heavy box. So this is much heavier than I would have expected, although they have made it thicker this year. And I do have the last generation to compare as far as size goes. But let's take this off here. And this particular model, if you were curious how much the actual cost is fairly expensive. So you can see the current configuration here, and it comes in at $4,899. So it's very expensive, starts around $3,000 or more, depending on if you get the 16 or the 14 inch. Let's go ahead and take the top off the box. So we'll remove the top here. There we go. And this is a huge laptop. So you'll see there's a little bit of a circle here. I believe that's in the paper. So, wow, that's a pretty heavy laptop. We'll set that aside for just a moment and take a look at what's in the box. So we have a charge cable and we're back to MagSafe. So let's go ahead and open this up. I like how they're not using any plastic or tape. They're just sort of using these little pull tabs. Just makes a lot more sense. So open these up and we have a braided MagSafe cable. So this comes out like this, wraps around. So we have a braided MagSafe cable. Here's the MagSafe connector at the end. It looks very familiar, although it looks a little bit thinner than previous generations. Then we have USB-C. And let's set that aside for a moment. We'll take a look at the paperwork that we get with it. And I ordered this in space gray. It does come in silver as well. Let's go ahead and take the literature out here. And you'll see we've got a quick start guide. And then we just have basically a safety and handling and warranty pamphlet. And I think we have Apple stickers in here, and we do. Just kind of stuck in the packaging. And we have 2 black Apple stickers, similar to that of the Mac Pro or the high-end Mac. So it's nice to see them putting the black stickers in here. It sort of signifies Pro when it comes to that. And then we have a power brick. So let's take a look at this. Take the power brick out. And this is pretty heavy duty. And we have the power brick. Now we don't get the extension cable with it, but you can purchase that separately. Or if you have an older Mac with the extension that goes here, you can just plug it in and then you have USB-C. And let's take a look around the outside and you'll see it's the 140 watt charger. So about 50% in 30 minutes or so. So I'll put this away and let's take a closer look at the MacBook. Before we do that, this MagSafe cable is about 6 feet long, if you were curious about that, and it is braided. So it's really nice and should be great to use, although you still can charge through USB-C. So here's the MacBook, and this comes in at 4.8 pounds if you have the M1 Max CPU. So if you have the M1 Pro, it's 4.7 pounds. So let's go ahead and remove the wrapper here. And you can see it says MacBook Pro on the bottom. So it's sort of engraved or pressed into the metal itself. And then you have 4 rubber feet and you've got the different screws like you would expect. You've also got vents on either side. So you have vents on each side of the MacBook. This is the back. And then on the left-hand side, you have your MagSafe. You have 2 Thunderbolt 4 or USB-C ports, an updated 3.5 millimeter headphone jack with better impedance, so it should work better with high-end headphones. Around the front, it looks pretty typical for a Mac. On the other side, we have an SD card slot, which is something I never thought we'd see return, another Thunderbolt 4 port, and an HDMI port. So all of those things. Now for a quick size comparison before we open it up, let's take a look at the last generation. You can see the size is a little bit different. It has a slightly different shape to the outside edge. And let's take a look at the side of it. So if I stand these up edge to edge, you get the idea of the overall size. You're almost a screen taller on the new MacBook Pro, but I'm okay with that with the extra ports. So it's a little bit taller It's about the same width and about the same height, but everything else is much thicker with all of those additional ports. So we'll open it up and take a closer look. And there we go. There's a look at the keyboard, and it automatically booted up. So this is a huge trackpad. We now have a completely black background on the keyboard, and all of the keys are black as well. We now have full-size function keys and our volume button back. And to me, this is much better than what we had with the previous generation with the touch bar. I was never a fan of the touch bar. Now you can see the keyboards. They definitely look different. And again, we have that full-size function row at the top, which is something, again, I thought we'd never see. So Touch ID is a normal size button, similar to that of the new Magic keyboards for the iMac. And if you take a look at the screens, they're a little bit different as well. So let me take this piece off here. And you can see the screen extends up to the corners. And as you move the mouse across, it actually goes through the notch. So let me show you that. So it goes through the notch. As I bring the mouse up to the top, you'll see it goes through. It doesn't go around the bottom. It just goes through as though the notch was never there. So now I'll set up the new MacBook and let's see what it looks like. This screen looks incredible already, and I'll get it all set up and then we'll run some benchmarks. Now, if you've never set up a MacBook, it's pretty simple. Just select your language, click next, then select your country or region. I'm in the United States, so again, select that and click continue. And then it's asking about accessibility features or settings that you might need in order to continue. So Apple has always brought this to the forefront. And if you need vision, motor, hearing, or cognitive help, you have those options. I'll just click not now. And now we connect to Wi-Fi. Now it's giving us some information about data and privacy. We'll click continue. Then it's asking if I want to migrate things from my other Mac to this Mac. I actually use iCloud a lot to back everything up and sync everything. The only thing I typically download is Final Cut Pro and those sorts of things that I need. So I'll go ahead and not back up. We'll hit not now. And now I'll put in my Apple ID. Once the Apple ID is in place, you have to agree to the terms of service. So I'll go ahead and click agree. Now we need to put in a password for the Mac itself. After setting up my account, I agreed to use Find My, and now it says make this your new Mac. And so you have options for Siri, screen time, file vault, disk encryption. All of these things are set to default. I'm just going to click continue. So we'll give it just a moment. You can turn off device analytics and app analytics and more, but it's nice that they just made that one screen. Now we have Touch ID. So let's go ahead and set that up. So we'll hit continue. And you just place your finger down like you would expect. There we go. And we'll do that again, just from different angles. There we go. And it says Touch ID is ready. We'll click continue. Now it asks if I want to set up Apple Pay. I'll set that up later. And now we're all ready to the home screen. It's asking if Calendar would like to use my location or if I'll allow it. I'll click OK. And you can see this is the home screen. Let's go ahead and check the version that's actually installed on this. So we'll click About This Mac. Now you can see the version that's on here is actually version 12.0. That means we're going to have an update. Apple released macOS Monterey yesterday, and it was version 12.0.1. So we should have an update. You'll see I have 64 gigabytes of RAM, and it's the Apple M1 Mac. So again, this is pretty top of the line, except I didn't opt for the 8 terabytes of storage. I'll go ahead and click software update, get that started, and get everything set up so we can check out a few benchmarks. You can see right away we have that update available. And if we go to more info, it's about 2.34 gigabytes. So I'll go ahead and install that and get this up to speed. Now, while I'm waiting for the update to install, you can see the top corners are rounded. So it's rounded around the edge, but it's squared off in the bottom left and bottom right-hand corner. That makes it look a little nicer at the top, I think. I like the rounded corners, similar to what we have on an iPhone. And they've got this notch now that sort of resides in the menu bar. So it's not protruding into the display. You're just getting a little extra room because of this bezel. I'm sure I'll get used to that pretty quickly. And once all of my applications are installed, I'm sure it will be fine once they update to that. Of course, when you're watching videos, it shouldn't protrude into the display because the display is taller now. So it's more of a 16 by 10 ratio where it's going to be a little bit taller. So it shouldn't protrude into that notch. You'll just have your information here with sort of the top blacked out if you're watching a video. Now, if you're curious about the specs, it's an M1 Max that I mentioned earlier, but the display is basically a Pro Display XDR on the go that goes up to 1600 nits peak brightness. It's mini LED and has huge dynamic range. It's 16.2 inches from corner to corner, and it's 3,456 by 2,234 with 254 pixels per inch. I don't know that there's a better display on the market in a MacBook or any other device on the market at all that's this bright. If I turn it all the way up, you won't be able to see it. And you can also adjust the refresh rate. It goes up to 120 hertz. It's got ProMotion. So if we go into display, we have some modes here. So you'll see it says Apple XDR display, P3, 1600 nits. And then we can change it to HDR video if we're editing that. You've got digital cinema, P3, DCI, and you have refresh rate set to ProMotion. However, if you're editing video and you want it set to maybe 60 hertz, just like a normal Mac display, you can do that, or you can bring it down further if you'd like. So whatever works for you. Again, we can have this display scaled. You can sort of mirror this over to a different display or extend it, and eventually we'll have universal control also. Now, Apple also updated the webcam to 1080p. You have additional sensors here in this notch, so ambient light sensors and more, but we don't have Face ID. However, we have the new 1080p webcam with the Neural Engine, should make it look a little bit better. But one thing we don't have is center stage like that of the iPad Pro. So that's something I'm surprised they didn't bring over since we have a similar processor. But I wanted to take a listen to this and see what it looks like since we have new studio mics as well. So let's see what it sounds like. So we'll open up QuickTime, then we'll go to File and New Movie Recording. Let's go ahead and make sure everything's on maximum. It is, and we'll hit record. And so now we're recording with the new MacBook Pro. This is the 1080p webcam to give you an idea of what it looks like. And also, I'm no longer recording with this microphone, but rather the mics inside the MacBook Pro. So I'll be interested to see what this sounds like as soon as I'm done editing this video. But in general, it looks pretty good. I'm just not sure it's going to be worthy of maybe using as your main camera if you're maybe live streaming or something. Although I could be wrong, it does look pretty decent and maybe good enough for that. But let me know what you think about the video and the microphones in the comments below. Now, another nice little touch is when you have the webcam active, you have a little green dot there to let you know that you're being recorded or that the camera is actually turned on. So again, another nice feature. It's just sort of a hardware feature to let you know that it's physically turned on. I thought we'd test the keyboard as well, since I'm still waiting for this to update. And let's see if it's any different than before. It seems to be the same as the last generation where they fixed everything. It's no longer the butterfly keyboard. So, hi, how are you today? And it seems to feel the exact same. Also, it sounds the same. So let me move my microphone so you can hear it. As you can see, I don't type normally, but it does sound pretty quiet as well. It doesn't have too much of a clicky sound, which I tend to like. Everything is set up, and I listened a little bit to the speakers, so I wanted you to hear what they sound like. Now, you're not going to get the same sort of spatial audio, but the overall sound is much better than I expected. So I downloaded a royalty-free song here I thought I'd let you listen to, and take a listen to this. I'll move my microphone so you can hear what they sound like. That gives you an idea of what the speakers are capable of. Of course, if you're sitting in front of it, it sounds really great. So I'm very impressed with the speakers overall. Now let's run just a couple benchmarks. So first we'll go into Blackmagic disk speed test, and we'll just hit start and see what we get. Immediately we get 6,413 for write speed and 5,381 for read speed. Now we're over 7,000 for write speed, and strangely we're lower for read speed, but close to about 5,777 megabytes a second for read speed. That's incredibly fast. Let me go ahead and run Geekbench on this. Now, synthetic benchmarks are not going to give you the general idea of what it's like to use, but it just sort of shows us what it's like compared to other devices. So we'll go into Geekbench 5 here. I just installed this, give it just a moment here. I'll run this and let's see what we get. So I'll run this one and then I'll also run a compute score as well. So we'll run the benchmark now. So the first benchmark completed, and here I have on the left my Core i9 MacBook Pro from late 2019. So this is the top of the line Core i9, and you'll see the single core is 1003. On the new M1 Max, it's 1780. For multi-core, we have 7,191. On the new M1 Max version, we have 12,520. Let's go ahead and close this, and we'll run a compute score next, and we'll run Metal. Geekbench scores for Metal completed, and we had 27,975. On the new M1 Max version, we have 68,553. So again, incredibly powerful. Now, in order to show the real processing power, it's just not something I'm going to be able to do easily. So I'm going to have to use it for a little while to see what it's like. And the new M1 Max 16-inch MacBook Pro will be my main editing computer from here on out. This is going to replace the Mac Pro, assuming that it's much faster, so we'll have to wait and see what it's like editing, but everything is sort of optimized for this. Now, as far as battery life, well, I'm at 77% battery life, and I've been doing everything in this video concurrently. I updated it. That took about 20 minutes. I installed a bunch of other programs. I ran those benchmarks, and we're still at 77% battery life. We could get up to 21 hours of battery life. Now, it's rare for me to be able to edit more than one video on something like this MacBook. However, it's looking like I may be able to edit a couple just on battery power alone. So I'll have to try that out and see what it's like. But if there's anything specifically you want to know about the new MacBook Pros, I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. So far, it seems great. It's definitely a very big laptop. I don't mind that at all, being someone that's going to use all of its features. And I'll have to try out the new DAC that's got a little higher impedance for the 3.5 millimeter headphone jack. One quick thing to note is this MacBook is not warm at all, hardly even a little, maybe just a bit on the bottom since I've been running those different benchmarks and things, but not hot like the other one. The Core i9 MacBook Pro would spin up its fans and get extremely hot. So I'm curious to see over the next few days if this gets really hot, and I'm okay with that as long as it sort of increases its performance compared to the traditional M1. So this M1 Max is something I've been looking forward to for a very long time. And like I said, if there's anything specifically you'd like to know about it that I can cover in maybe a full review, let me know in the comments below. If you haven't subscribed already though, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.